Welcome. This is a history of modern philosophy. My name is Mark Thorsby. In this video series, we're conducting a survey of key philosophers from Descartes to Nietzsche. I encourage you to follow along. We're using the book Classics of Philosophy, edited by Pajman and Vaughan from Oxford University Press. But all of the texts we're looking at are freely available online. All you need to do is Google it or go to Google Books. So I encourage you to follow along. It's really key that you read these texts because not everything that's in the text is discussed in these videos. I try to just pull out the things that are most pertinent for our discussion. So welcome back, everyone. It's great to have you back. What we're going to be looking at today is Thomas Hobbes, who's a pretty important philosopher who lived around in the 1600s and in the 17th century. And what we're going to be looking at here is sort of his discussion of how knowledge is generated, his epistemology, and of course we're going to be taking a look at in particular some of the aspects of his political philosophy, namely his discussion about the state of nature and so forth. Now, if you've been watching the video series, you know that in our last video we discussed René Descartes' Meditations on First Philosophy. And at the end of that video, some of the conclusions that Descartes made was he ultimately concluded in favor of a metaphysical or an ontological dualism. Dualism here, of course, refers to the idea for Descartes that we have both a mind and a body, and that the two cannot be reduced to each other. And so they're qualitatively distinct, separate, yet somehow co-present. Descartes also argued that if we begin with this question of if we doubt all that can be doubted, what can we know? Consequently, his argument was that because God is not a deceiver, we can reject this radical doubt, and that the senses, in fact, do indicate external objects. And so, if you'll recall, our sort of primary question throughout all of these videos is whether or not objective knowledge can be given from a subjective foundation. So, and Descartes articulates what's known as a sort of rationalist philosophy, and he really creates the rationalist school in philosophy. And again, rationalism is this basic idea that knowledge, that some things can only be known through reason. And we're going to see today that there's a sort of counterpoint to Descartes' rationalism known as empiricism. Now, we're going to look at empiricism quite a bit throughout the video series here. But empiricism, we'll see that Thomas Hobbes is an empiricist, but he's not a prominent empiricist, really. Not as much as we're going to see when we take a look at the work of John Locke. Now, Thomas Hobbes is a contemporary of Descartes. So he lived, as you can see here, from 1588 to 1679. Hobbes was born in Westbury, England, and so he actually begins, in my view, or he's the earliest progenitor of what later will be known as the British empiricist tradition. Now, Hobbes here, we have to be a bit careful because usually when you talk about British empiricism, most philosophers are referring specifically to John Locke, David Hume, and probably George Berkeley. These are the key empirical British philosophers, but Thomas Hobbes is a British philosopher, contemporary of Descartes, and he's going to articulate quite a bit of discussion about how knowledge can be gained and what it means to have knowledge. And his theory of mind is ultimately that the knowledge begins with our experience of the world. So he thinks that and empiricism is the notion that knowledge is given through our experience, right? Through our empirical experience. So we're going to see him talk about it. Now, some of the things that's interesting about Thomas Hobbes is he was actually born on the day of the Spanish Armada sighting. Now, you may remember when you took, maybe in high school or elementary school or maybe college, you know that in the late 1500s, Spain was basically a major power within Europe, a major naval power. And the Spanish sent an entire armada, a whole fleet of ships, in order to invade England. The day that Hobbes was born, there was a sighting of the Spanish armada. Now, you probably also know that the Spanish armada was destroyed because of terrible weather at sea. So the Spanish Armada never made it to England, but they were sighted, and it actually freaked everyone out. And in fact, Thomas Hobbes' mother said that because she was pregnant at the time, she said that she went into birth because she was terrified of, you know, an invasion, that an invasion fleet was coming literally within hours. So she famously said that, Thomas Hobbes famously said that his mom, that she gave birth to twins, both myself and fear. because one of the things you'll see is that, especially that if you're able to read more thoroughly into Thomas Hobbes' work, is that fear actually plays a central ingredient for his analysis of political philosophy. And he thinks we're mainly motivated by fear, politically and socially. So it's sort of interesting. It begins that, and Thomas Hobbes himself noticed this. Now, Hobbes was educated at Oxford, and he spent most of his life as really a scholar and a tutor. He was widely regarded, and he was also quite controversial. I mean, it's important to remember here that England at this point is a highly Christianized nation, and we'll see that Hobbes doesn't deny Christianity or deny God overtly, but his philosophy sets the stage for later secularization, I think. And that was sort of anticipated. Hobbes, in fact, was forced to flee at one point in his life, flee England and then return. His key idea that we'll see and that we'll discuss in this video, and I've discussed in other videos, is that morality and politics arise out of a social contract. So ultimately, there's this very interesting notion that for Hobbes, our moral beliefs and our moral understanding of what's wrong and right and these sorts of things is ultimately generated out of natural human conditions and the natural social agreements we have with other people, which is quite revolutionary for his day. In fact, it's revolutionary for a lot of people today, right? He thinks that ultimately what's wrong and what's right is ultimately based upon some degree of social covenant. Now, it's not completely that way, because he does have a sort of natural law theory, where he thinks there are certain natural laws or natural predispositions that human people have in terms of, you know, their self-preservation and so forth. And then he thinks that these natural laws essentially form the foundation upon which other moral theories are generated. Now, we're going to see in today's reading, we're not going to focus too heavily in his politics and morality. We are going to take a look at it, but we're really going to be focusing on the really beginning works of his view of how sensation is acquired, or how knowledge is generated from sensation. And then we're going to look and see how that for him feeds into his political philosophy. Now, the key work that Thomas Hobbes wrote was called the Leviathan, which is a biblical reference, in fact. There's a picture of the man himself. So that's what we're taking a look at in this video. A very interesting philosopher. And what you might also say is that in many ways, the social political systems we have today within most modern democratic republics are fundamentally based upon the ideas that Thomas Hobbes argued for. Now, we have to be clear, Thomas Hobbes doesn't argue for a democratic system per se, but he thinks that his social contract theory forms the basis for all legitimate forms of government, whether they be democratic or even monarchies. So it's a sort of universal thing. And certainly when we get to John Locke in a later video, you're going to see a strong resemblance. And clearly Locke was an avid reader of Hobbes and knew Hobbes' work well. But he revises some of Hobbes' thinking. Okay, so let's jump into it. So, and you're going to see, by the way, that in each one of these slides, what I may be focused on are a certain couple elements that come from different chapters of the Leviathan. Now, the first part of the Leviathan is on man. It's called Of Man. One of the things that's nice, too, is that you can read the Leviathan in Hobbes' own writing if you're an English speaker, as I am, which is quite nice. Most of the philosophers, for instance, we looked at last week are written in other languages, but if you speak English, you can read Hobbes directly. But you will find that his style of writing is quite archaic compared to ours. And a lot of the diction and the concepts he has, you may not be familiar with. Now, the first chapter he looks at here is on sense, sensation. Okay? And it begins with sort of a discussion of thoughts, right? We all have thoughts. And of course, keep in mind here the discussion we looked at with Descartes. I forgot to mention, Hobbes was well known at the time, and Descartes' meditations, after they were published, Descartes sent them to a number of scholars and intellectuals throughout Europe, including Thomas Hobbes. And in fact, Thomas Hobbes raises a number of objections to Descartes' Meditations on Philosophy. And you can read the replies. We're not going to discuss that here. But so there is a relationship here and an awareness between, and a dialogue between Hobbes and Descartes. In fact, the Leviathan is published 10 years after Descartes' Meditations on First Philosophy, exactly 10 years later. Okay, so we begin with this question. If we want to understand what sensation is, we have to begin by first discussing what a thought is. So for instance, at a very basic level, clearly we have thoughts. So when I close my eyes and I think about, you know, what am I going to do today? And I think in words, those are thoughts. But it's also clear that when I experience something, that too is a type of thought. So it looks like if we start with thoughts, we have to begin by differentiating three different types of thoughts. Now, for Hobbes, he and again, here's the sort of language, archaic language he uses here, a lack of precision. And we have to be patient with Hobbes because he's inventing this. Hindsight's easy, 2020, right? But thoughts, we can distinguish three types or three different ways of looking at thoughts. The first is, what are thoughts in themselves? Hobbes calls this the thoughts taken singly, right? Taken in themselves or just individually. We can also ask ourselves, well, what's the relationship between thoughts when they're combined together? That is, what about a train of thoughts, right? And finally, another question here is, how are thoughts dependent upon each other? It's clear that when we make arguments, we make statements, each of those statements is thought individually, but they're put in combination. And if we have a strong argument, that combination also represents a set of dependencies, right? So when I argue that all men are mortal, Socrates is a man, therefore Socrates is mortal, right? I have three different thoughts in a combination, but there's a dependency between each of the statements. And although Hobbes doesn't refer to this, today we would talk about this in terms of inference, right? What is the inference and the dependent relationships between our thoughts? So you can see here, there's a lot of a nexus of issues we've got to look at. Now, for Hobbes, if we take thoughts in themselves, the first thing he says is that thoughts begin as representations of objects, right? So when I say the word cup is a thought in my mind, but it represents an object, right? In this case, this physical cup. Now, it's also clear that not all thoughts represent physical objects, right? Some thoughts represent abstract objects, right? So when I talk about, let's say, the golden ratio or something, right? That's an abstraction, but the golden ratio does have an object to it as a thought. So thoughts are representative in nature. Now, where does the first thoughts arise from? In Hobbes's view, the original thoughts are equated with sense or sensation. Now, this means that he's ultimately something of an empiricist, right? Because that means that our thoughts begin from our experience, or they begin from sensation, put more specifically. Okay, now, so the original thoughts begin in sense, and all of the rest of the thoughts are somehow derived from the original, okay? So you can see here that that would mean, fortuitously, that abstract thoughts must have some sort of origination in some sort of sensation. And we're going to see that John Locke really agrees with that idea, and he refines it to some degree. Instead of talking to the word, using the words thoughts, he uses the term ideas. And later on, when we talk about David Hume, we're going to see that David Hume also agrees with that idea, but he refines it even further. So in many ways, Hobbes begins a sort of train of development within philosophy. Now, and so all of the rest of the thoughts that we have are ultimately and must ultimately be derived from these original thoughts that arise in sense. So this first chapter on sense is really quite important. Because think about it, if you're going to do a political philosophy or any sort of philosophy, you have to begin by first understanding what it means to have a thought in any way from the get-go. Now, so this means that he then goes on to say that our senses are derived from, he describes it as an external pressing, and he refers it always in terms of motion. So his idea here is that when I have, let's take my coffee cup here, when I have a cup, the object somehow presses itself upon me through some sort of motion externally, right? So this, so you can see here that it's a very, very different mindset than we saw in Descartes. And this would also explain why Hobbes is his objections, and in many ways, I don't think that Hobbes recognized at the time the fundamental impact that Descartes had. And maybe I'm wrong about that, but when I read his objections and replies, I don't think he recognizes the revolutionary nature of what we looked at last time. But that's because, remember, Descartes, he doubts all of these external things. And here Hobbes says, no, he sort of starts with a sort of common sense idea, which is, well, it looks like all of my thoughts do come from this external world. And somehow, the objects I experience press themselves through some kind of motion onto me. Now, it's clear by this time, and it's clear to us today, that the pressings and the motions obviously must refer to somehow light and light waves and this sort of thing. Of course, Thomas Hobbes doesn't have a theory of light waves at all or whatsoever, but clearly light waves are in motion. So it's fundamentally, I think, or at least in the beginning, and on the face of it, prima facie, it looks like Hobbes's empiricism really sort of corresponds in many ways to our own. Now, Hobbes also says that we have to distinguish different types of sensations. There is a way in which the senses can impress themselves onto me in an immediate sense, but there's also times in which sensation gets mediated. So he makes a distinction here between pressings that are immediately given versus mediated pressings or indirect. I think the language here would probably be easier for us if we distinguish between direct sensation from indirect sensation. Okay, let's move here to the next chapter. So that's the first sort of thing, just to begin, is that he has this empiricist view. Now, it's very interesting. I love Hobbes here because he starts with this sort of puzzle of inertia, right? Now, it's clear to us that Hobbes says that if you put an object down on the table, right? So if I put my coffee cup down on the table, it's clear that the coffee cup will remain still unless someone does something to it, right? And this should go on, at least in principle, indefinitely forever, right? So that if I put something down, it'll stay at rest forever, right? And he says, we recognize that intuitively as making sense. We don't have a problem with that. But when we talk about the law of inertia, now he doesn't use the term inertia, but I'm using it because I'm assuming that most of you watching the video are familiar with the basics of Newtonian mechanics, right? And the law of inertia is that things will remain in motion unless they're acted upon, or they will stay still unless they're acted upon, right? So things, when they're in motion, the motion just should go on indefinitely unless something else stops it or acts to intervene. Now, but this sort of raises a puzzle for Hobbes, which is namely, well, when I say that if something's in motion, it should stay in motion forever, right? It's hard to imagine that that's the case. It's not as easy to imagine that as it is the cup being still forever, right? So there's a sort of difficulty of imagination here. And so Hobbes sort of uses this puzzle to really begin to sort of ask, well, what does it mean to have an imagination? Now, we should say that you can take a look at it in your own research, but Hobbes does address it to some degree, is that in the medieval world, the medievals had this concept that things would run out of motion, as it were, right? It was at one point, by one thinker, it's called the notion of, what's the name of it? I can't remember all of a sudden. It'll come to me, right? But the idea was that things would naturally just decline, so that when you throw a ball, it runs out of motion, and so that's why it falls, right? So the medieval view was the idea that didn't have this imagination problem, because in the medieval view, things just sort of ran out of steam, as it were, and that's why they would stop. So their view was that things in motion tend towards rest. But this is not the contemporary scientific view. So how do we imagine this, and why is it we have this difficulty to imagine? Now, the notion of imagining, right, the term image here comes from the Latin. And literally, the imagination means something in Latin refers to the image made seeing. Now, In Greek, the same sort of discussion of the faculty of imagination is referred to for Hobbes here in the language of fancy. So there seems to be a sort of difference here. What does it mean to imagine? Now, and I should be clear, for Hobbes, the imagination refers to the ability to image a thought. So we're not talking about imagination where we're talking about the imagination in terms of it being a faculty of the mind. We're not talking about the imagination in terms of creativity, right? So a lot of times we say, have a good imagination, right? That's not what he's talking about. That it's more simple than that. Is that to, like when I say the word ball, an image arises in your mind, right? So then that is a thought. So where do those thoughts come from? Well, we already know from the first chapter that they must come from sense. So it looks like the imagination is a sort of form of decaying sense. I love the words he uses here, right? It's a, I've seen a ball in the past, and somehow I'm able to recall through my memory, recall that ball, but that ball is a sort of, I have a sensation of it, but it's not as visceral as the immediate sensation I once had. It's mediated through the memory, and it seems to be sort of decaying, right? So this is what memory is for him. And ultimately, imagine the faculty of imagination is fundamentally based upon the systems of memory that we have. Now, when we talk about the imagination, Hobbes distinguishes between simple and compound imagination. Now, to image something simply is to image a specific, unified, single object or thing, right? So when I just say the word ball, you can imagine a ball. Now, the example Hobbes gives here, as I believe, is he gives the example of Alexander the Great, right? And so I've sort of put up a picture here of Alexander the Great. The simple imagination is just to recognize the image of Alexander from the beginning. But when you see Alexander on a horse, well, right, you have a simple imaging of a horse, a simple imaging of a man, and they get compounded together, right? So Hobbes's view here is that the imagination begins with the simple, but there's also compound, right? Now, most of what we're experiencing, of course, you can just pause the video, look around your room or wherever you're at, and you have mainly just compound images, right? Compound sensations. And when you imagine, for instance, Alexander the Great, or you imagine your first birthday party or something like that, usually you're imagining compounds, but every compound must be based upon the simple, or a combination of simples, as it were. Now, okay? Now, it's one of the things interesting is when he talks about, it's a very interesting sort of discussion, I'm not going to go too much into it, but he does talk about dreams, and he says that a dream is basically the imagination in sleep. So when you're asleep, your faculty of imagination seems to continue to work because you image things, right? And the imagination, and he actually talks a little bit about, okay, this raises some interesting questions about how you can interpret dreams, and there's all this sort of stuff, which I'm not going to go into because I think I don't know if it's totally relevant for us, but it is interesting. But the imagination is raised by words or signs is understanding. So he thinks that we have words, and our words operate as signs, which help us conjure the image. So you can see he's building a sort of systematic evaluation of what it means to think and experience, right? So the imagination is raised by words. So when I say the word ball, that raises an image in your mind, and that the operation by way in which I understand your words through my imagination, this is what understanding is, right? And there's something right about this, right? Imagine if when you're in a class or you're talking to someone or you're watching a video or something, and someone says, they use words and they say something that you don't understand. The problem there, at least for Hobbes, is that the words don't have the representational content in your imagination. That's why you don't understand it, right? And he does talk about here, for instance, the relationship between dogs and men. I put woman here because I don't want to be sexist, and I think we can sort of update that a little bit. Of course, Hobbes definitely sort of has a masculine language here that certain feminist thinkers would certainly object to. I won't get into that. So, but that's why it says woman here, or woe's men, right? It's sort of, I guess, my political correctness. But for instance, dogs clearly probably do have some degree of imagination, it would seem, right? Because it looks like We don't know because we don't experience what a dog says, but dogs do not seem to have understanding, right? They do not seem to understand words, whereas human beings do, right? So this raises an important distinction for Hobbes between the difference between animals and human beings. And ultimately, of course, this will give rise to a more precise understanding of, in terms of his politics eventually, of why human political communities are not the same as animal social existence. So we'll talk about that later. Okay, let's move here to chapter 3. And here we're sort of, okay, what about the consequences of the imagination and senses, and what about this idea of we have trains of imaginations? And you can ask yourself sort of, well, what happens in a train of imagination? So in a train of thought, right? Because now remember, thoughts are based upon senses. Senses are re-imaged, and then to understand something is based upon your ability, the science, to have this representational content. So what exactly is happening when you have a train of thought? Now, when you say train, what are we talking about? We're talking about the succession of one thought to another, right? And what that is mental discourse, right? And here you can think about, well, whenever you think, you have a train of thought, and this is your own mental discourse. Well, here's how Hobbes will lay out some of these. And again, I'm not covering everything he discusses, just the things that I think are pertinent to our video today. The first is that thoughts don't always go together, right? So this is an important thing to recognize, is that not every thought can be put into a train of thought easily, right? Some thoughts just don't go together, whereas other thoughts do seem to go together, right? So for instance, imagine if I say, it's raining outside, so you should put on a coat. That goes together. But imagine if I say, it's raining outside, so there's a dragon named Billy, sitting on your shoulder. Well, that doesn't seem to go together at all, right? So what makes thoughts go together? Now, his view here is that thoughts are a form of decaying sense. And because of their a form of decaying sense that's based upon that which is outside of me externally, that the thoughts go together in an analogous way. He doesn't use this term, but I think it's the most appropriate for us. It means that our thoughts have an order of fit, right? There's a way in which they fit together, and that ordering of fit is based upon the order of sense, right? Right? Dragons don't go together with rain, not essentially, right? So there's not an order of fit there, right? But and so his view here is that all of this is ultimately based upon sensation in the external world. So if it goes together in the world, it goes together in our mind. At least that's how I understand him. That means there's two types or two sorts of mental discourse that seem to be possible, right? There's the unguided, and then the unguided seems to be, when you just have all kinds of thoughts sort of going in and out. They're not necessarily related together in a consistent way. And then the second is the more constant. And you can have thoughts which are regulated by desire or design, right? So you can have thoughts that are regulated by desire and design. And this would be the notion that you have a sort of rational operation that's guiding the relationship between your thoughts, right? So that means you have two sorts of regulated thoughts, right? There's two types of these constant thoughts. The first seem to be those types of regulated thoughts, which he refers to as really being causal. So, for instance, you have a thought and you want to understand the relationship of what caused that thought. That is, you try to you re, you can relate trains of thought in terms of the means of their production, right? You have one thought, and how did you get this thought? Well, something came before it. So imagine if I tell you my thought is someone just walked in out of someone walked in and they're all wet and they have an umbrella. Well, a natural thought in terms of what caused that thought would be the idea that it's raining outside, right? So you have causal. You can also have a regulated thought that aims in terms of the effects, right? So you could say it's raining outside, and then I could then create another train of thought and say, well, since it's raining outside, the effect is you're going to get wet when you go outside. So you can relay your ideas not in terms of the means by which they're produced, but in terms of the effects of each other, right? The effects of from one thought to another. So it's sort of, I think one way of that might be helpful to understand this would be to say that the first type of regulated thought is essentially backward looking, Whereas the second type of regulated thought would be forward-looking. To me, that's easier for me to remember. So that's how that seems to be what he's arguing here. Now, you can see here, cause and effect is a really principal key notion here. Now, it is important that he does recognize that fallacious forms of reasoning are possible. Now, remember, a fallacy, well, we've never covered it, so maybe you don't remember it, you don't know it, but a fallacy is a false argument. And a fallacy is when you have trains of thought that don't actually make sense together. People make all kinds of fallacies that are arguments or claims that aren't really backed up, not really that reasonable, doesn't make sense. So it's important to recognize that even though you can have regulated thought, just because it's regulated in terms of the desire or the design, but that doesn't mean necessarily that a regulated form of thought is actually makes sense at the end of the day. So there are fallacious forms of reasoning possible. And this is really quite important for us because clearly there's lots of times in which we make mistakes in our reasoning, even though we have regulated thought. So regulation of thought does not necessitate the validity of a thought, okay? Or of an argument or of a train of thoughts. Okay, now we're sort of jumping ahead, and you see I'm sort of jumping all around. Let's take a look at chapter 6 regarding the interior beginnings of voluntary motions, okay? And here we're sort of, okay, what does it mean for a person internally to begin to think and to begin to do things, right? And how is it that people have voluntary motions? And so it's not just about thought, it's also about your body, right? But there's an interesting question here about the relationship between the subjective and our relationship to the world here. Now, not Descartes, Hobbes says there are really two different types of bodily motions. The first are vital motions, and these are essentially involuntary motions that are necessary for our existence. This is things like breathing. If you touch your blood vessels, you can feel your heart beating. These are vital motions, he calls them. I think maybe the term would be better involuntary, but he uses the term vital. The second are voluntary motions, and these are ones in which I do things on my own. And this principally is what Hobbes is interested in discussing. Now, he does distinguish, he says, for instance, he says that before I actually begin to move, there seem to be what he calls small beginnings of motion, right? So for instance, before I start to pick up the coffee cup, I first have to have some sort of small beginning where I start to move. Somehow there's a beginning generation of motion. He calls this I guess the faculty of endeavoring to do something. He calls this endeavor, right? So to endeavor is to have this small beginning of motion. And I'm not fully clear on all of Hobbes's empiricism personally, but it seems to me that thinking can also be a form of endeavoring, right? So before I even just start to pick up the coffee cup and move my motions, move my body, my muscles just tense up a little bit, I had also seemed to think a thought, right? So it looks like thought can also have this endeavoring quality. Now he does say that one of the other motions that we seem to be capable of, voluntary motions, are appetite or desire. And this is when you have the endeavoring is applied to something which causes it. So he has this view that I see the coffee cup and I want a cup of coffee, and so I move towards it, right? Or maybe another example is think about a dog that barks and leaps at you. You would move and get out of the way, right? Or if you wanted to grab something, when the object moves my motion, this is desire, right? But there's also, you can also have the object makes you have an aversion, and when endeavor becomes, he calls it fromward something, but when you want to get away from something, this is aversion. And so he seems to link, or he does link this to the notion of love and hate, right? So he has this sort of interesting, I think, probably from our purposes, a sort of rudimentary psychological theory that has probably a lot of problems. But he sees that these motions seem to be what we refer to when we say we love something or when we hate something. It's this aversion. Endeavor is sort of the key notion here. We also have contemn, right? And this is when we have immobility, or the continuancy of the heart in resisting the action of certain things, I completely screwed up the spelling on this sentence, so my apologies, right? But the notion there is there's some things in which we resist action. So not only do we have endeavorings, but we also have moments where we refuse to act, which is also an important sort of element. Now, given that with these bodily motions, he then goes into a discussion, which is important here, about the different types of things which are good, because it looks like we generally endeavor towards things which are good. Now, he distinguishes three types of good. There's things which are good in terms of promise, things which are good in terms of effect, and things which are good as means, right? So there's good in terms of things we desire. I think that's what he means in terms of promise. I guess we could desire all of these. But there's some things which are good because of the effects they create. So some things are good in and of themselves. They're good as such. So they are good in the promise of having them themselves. There's other things which are good in terms of the effects they create. And there's other things which are good simply as an instrument. Let me see if I can give an example. I think that I desire my wife's love, right? And I think that's a good in promise, right? I desire education, or let's say, you're taking this class or you're learning about philosophy, let's say because you want a degree. Well, a degree is good in terms of its effect, or you could say an education becomes good in terms of the effect of getting the degree. Now, I think education is good also in promise as well. There's also things as good as a means, right? So for instance, exercise is good as a means. Now, because of these goods, now we start to get the sense that for Hobbes, our motions are based upon a pursuit and an endeavor and an appetite towards these goods. And this is how we understand what pleasure is. So we get this important sort of discussion from Hobbes, or quote from Hobbes, which is, pleasure, therefore, is the appearance or the sense of good. So when we recognize something as being good, we have a sense of it or an appearance of it, that's what pleasure is, right? And in molestation or displeasure, or the appearance or the sense of this displeasure or molestation is evil. So we get this distinction between good and evil is ultimately identified as being with pleasure and displeasure, right? So you have this sense in which Hobbes, beginning from an empirical epistemology, ultimately works his way into sort of hedonistic view here, where we naturally associate the good as being pleasure and pain or displeasure as being evil. So you have a certain sort of hedonism at work as well. Now, I'm not going to go into all of this, but Hobbes then uses this analysis to then lay out a theory of really using his theory of sensation. He lays out an understanding of all of these terms and all of these which before had been considered sort of virtues. Hope, joy, grief, fear, courage, anger, confidence, diffidence, benevolence, ambition, magnanimity, valor, fortitude, kindness, natural lust, luxury, the passions of loves, and he gives many, many more examples here. All of these words for him are ultimately representative of the types of goods we're after, and the types of motions we make towards those goods, okay? So he sort of lays out, using a general theory of sensation here, he tries to lay out an analysis and an articulation of what previously had been considered virtues of character, and he really turns them, I think, into sort of psychological categories, you know? And at the end here, which I think is important, Hobbes then begins to discuss speech. And speech is really, really critical. And I think by the end of the course here, we'll talk more about what speech is as we sort of go through all this, especially with maybe someone like David Hume later on. But even Descartes. So in our last week's video, Descartes argued that the cogito ergo sum, or in other words, I am, I exist, is necessarily true whenever it's said. Right, so Descartes' entire rationalist philosophy relies upon the notion of a speech act. Right, so speech is really, really important here. And what Hobbes seems to talk about here is that, okay, deliberation, when we deliberate and we use speech to understand and debate, and is expressed subjunctively. Right, now, something is subjunctive when it ultimately reveals a sort of desires, right? So deliberation is expressed as a sort of function of desire, right? It's one of these endeavoring motions, right? So, or I should say, the endeavoring motions give rise to deliberation. Here's the quote. He says, which is a speech proper to signify suppositions with their consequences, right? So that means that deliberation is a type of speech act that tries to understand the suppositions of things and the consequences of those suppositions, which of course, as we know, are all trains of thought. Now, most deliberation, though, takes place in regard to particulars, right? We talk about coffee cups, we talk about what time where should we go on our vacation, you know, at what time should I meet you for our meeting? Most deliberation is about these sorts of particulars. Of course, Hobbes knows that philosophical deliberation is really about universals, right? And this, of course, particulars and universals relates to a classic distinction in medieval as well as classical philosophy, and it becomes an important distinction later on in modern philosophy as well. Now, the voluntary deliberation is also a voluntary signification of passion. So some speech acts, sometimes we use our speech, we're actually just signifying our passion for things. So we have the distinction here, though it's not clearly laid out, I don't think, in Hobbes, between rational deliberation and I think what you might call emotive deliberation or rhetorical deliberation. Okay, so we get an interesting discussion of passion. Now, jumping ahead here to chapter 10, what I want to next take a look at is his discussion of power. And this becomes very, very important because we're going to see that he's really laid out, or we've discussed the basic mechanics of how Hobbes lays out his empirical epistemology. The next sort of question is, okay, how does this get applied to the world? And in particular, most notably, and I would say it's most notable because his most important contribution to the Western world, really, or to the whole world, is the notion of politics and understanding what politics is. And so Hobbes begins with this, okay, what is power? He says, the power of a man, to take it universally, is his present means to obtain some good and is either original or instrumental, okay? So that means that the power of human beings as a species, in the power of an individual, of course, resides in their ability to do things. That means that power is about the present means, what I can accomplish towards some end, right? So, for instance, if I want to, for instance, make a video lecture, right? If I have the means to do so, then I have the power to do so, right? And so all of the power that I'm able to have is ultimately resides in what I'm able to accomplish as a means, right? So that's first off and foremost what a power is. Now, Hobbes does, there's sort of 11 points about power he makes, and I want to go through them quickly with you. The first is a natural power. Now, something, let's see if I can zoom in here a little bit. The natural power of something refers to the faculty of mind and body, right? So I have the ability to think and I have the ability to move, and these are my natural powers. Now, of course, if I get in a car accident and I lose my legs, right, obviously my natural power diminishes. If I get dementia because I contract or I exhibit Alzheimer's later in my life, then that means my natural power gets diminished. So this is what natural power is. We'll ultimately see that he thinks everyone's natural power is, for the most part, equal, or at least in the aggregate. Now, compound power is the greatest of all the power, and compounded power is when we combine our powers through consent, right? So for instance, if I agree to do something and you agree to do it and we consent to work together, that means that our natural power gets combined together, gets compounded, and that compound power means that we have greater means than we would if we were merely just doing something individually. So compound power is the greatest, and that's why I put it in red there for you, right? For Hobbes, that's really critical, and we'll see especially when he begins to talk about social contract theory, or he doesn't really use the term social contract theory, he uses the term of covenants. So we'll see that there's covenants and agreements and consent, And this increases our power. Now, there is other ways of thinking about power. For instance, when we talk about riches and liberality, that's also power. That is, when I have a lot of resources and I have the freedom to use those resources, that's an increase in power. Another way in which we can refer to power is when we talk, or he says, the reputation of power is also power, right? So, for instance, if I have a reputation of being able to do something, then people act on that reputation, which means that I have power. So that's interesting, right? So that means that sometimes, even though I may not actually have the means, if people think I have the means, that actually gives me power. And this is very interesting, and it relates to an earlier philosopher in the Renaissance, Machiavelli, who talks about who has a similar insight here, representation of power. So reputation matters because if you have a good reputation, it increases your means, right? Good success is also power because if you're successful, then that means your means increase. You can see it always comes down to means for him. Now, the affability of men already in power, it creates an increase in power, right? So if other people who already have power become affable to myself, then that increases my own power. That means that nobility is power for him, which, remember, nobility is a key concept for his in his day. Today, the notion of nobility really plays a very, I think, a footnoting role here. We do still have a sense of nobility in some degree, though it's been severely diminished, I think, especially at least in the United States. There is a sense of nobility still in England, of course, though I would say it is too has qu greatly diminished since Hume's day, not Hume, Hobbes' day. So nobility is power. Eloquence is power, right? To be eloquent, to be rhetorically powerful in your speech is a form of power as well. Here's another one. He says form is power, right? And the notion there is that when you can, if you have a certain type of form and you can recognize that form and employ that form, that creates a certain type of power too. Sciences are a small power, right? Sciences are interesting here. Now, Hobbes, when he talks about science, his view of science, now remember, he's living in the scientific revolution like Descartes. So for him, so he reckons, so they're still coming to grasp with the scientific method and so forth and what science is exactly. But when Hume discusses science, not Hume, I keep making that mistake, when Hobbes discusses science, right, Hobbes says that science is really about a type of deliberation in which you're able to attain universal knowledge of things, right? So sciences give you knowledge about the way the world really is. And that gives you power, right? Because obviously now you know how to do things, right? So, for instance, if I know about, let's say I'm a gardener and I have enough biological sciences, I know botany and I know something about plants, that gives me more power because it gives me more means to be a good gardener. So, sciences also increase your power. But he calls it the small power, right? And he says, even the arts. There's the arts of public use are also a type of power, right? So there's lots of different types of power potentially, but all of them conform ultimately to this notion of natural power and compound power. Those are the most important, I think. Now, when we talk about value, what does it mean for something to have value? There's a couple of quotes I wanted to pull from this text for you. The first here, the value or the worth of a man is as all other things his price. That is to say, so much as would be given for the use of his power, right? So the value of another person for Hobbes, the worth of another person, ultimately consists in their power and how that power can be used, right? So someone isn't worth a lot if their power cannot be employed or used. So for instance, if I fall into a vegetative state, right? And for the rest of my life, I'm just drooling and I can't talk anymore and that kind of thing. Maybe I get in some sort of horrible car accident. Then the wor my worth, my value decreases, right? My value decreases accordingly. And that is my price decreases, right? As it were. Now, the manifestation of value we set on one another is that it is that is commonly called honoring or dishonoring, right? So when we set value on other people, this is what honoring or dishonoring is. Now it's interesting because today, I don't think we have much of, at least in the United States and probably most of the world, we no longer have a culture of an honor culture. In Hobbes' day, he lived in an honor culture where honor was a very important sort of concept. A great philosopher, Akil Bilgrami, has a whole discussion of this in his book on honor. I think it's called The Honor Code. But here we say when we set the values of each other and it manifests itself through what we call honor, right? So think about when someone bestows an honor upon another person, right? Think about when the President of the United States, gives someone a Medal of Honor, or think about when the Queen of England honors someone by knighting a person, right? That means that they're saying this person has great value, great worth, and that means because they have great use of power, right? So for Hobbes, it all boils down to power, really. Right, and the public worth of a person, which is the value set on them by the commonwealth, is what we commonly call dignity. Right, so everyone has a sort of public dignity, and that public dignity for him is based upon their worth, which is based upon their power and their use, the means by which they're able to do things. Okay, so you can see here that he has a power-centric view of human relations. Okay, so let's move here next to chapter 11, and this is on the difference of manners. Now, Hobbes knows that you're going to be thinking of manners in the sense of I have to make sure I use the right salad fork and this sort of thing. He says that's not what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about bad behavior. When he talks about manners, what he's referring to are the qualities of mankind that concern their living together in peace, right? So the question here is, it's clear that human beings have a certain way and a certain mode of being, a mode of acting, in which they live together in peace. And there are certain qualities that enable this. And this is what he means when he talks about manners, right? And it's here in this section that I think we really see from in a very strong sense that Thomas Hobbes is an egoist, right? And Thomas Hobbes is known for conforming to a form of what's known as psychological egoism. Egoism is the notion that, or psychological egoism is the notion that one is naturally and can only pursue their own self-interest, right? They're only going to really be worried about themselves at the end of the day, right? So for instance, even the person who helps the old lady across the street, or to be fair, the old man across the street, right? They're even though it seems like they're being nice and they're doing it, altruistically to help other people, from Hobbes' perspective, they're ultimately always going to be doing something for their own sake and right for themselves. Now, what he says though, he doesn't use the term egoism, that's sort of a contemporary term. What he does say really is that all mankind has a general inclination for a perpetual and restless desire of power after power that only ceases in death, right? So Hobbes' view is that human beings are naturally just want more and more power, and we're constantly trying to get more and more power, and that we'll do this all the way up until we die, right? So this is the sense of psychological egoism we have. And what is power? Power is trying to attain these means, whether they be through eloquence, etc., right? So we all have this inclination of power, right? And so our manners, which are the qualities that allow us to live together in peace, these manners are fundamentally based upon our natural egoistic condition. Now, this condition is given through a constant sort of competition, right? And Hobbes talks about the idea that we're in competition with each other for riches, for honor, for command, for other power that inclines to contention, enmity, and war. So there's a lot of competition psychologically, right? And so basically, the thing I haven't mentioned here is that, and we'll see it in the next chapter, is that all human beings, in his view, are naturally trying to get power, right? And they're trying to get, but they can't get all their power, and so they're in competition, and so somehow the difference of manners must arise accordingly. Now, for Hobbes, when we talk about desire, let's zoom it out here, there's different types of things which we desire accordingly. There's the desire for knowledge. There's the desire for ease, right? There's the desire for praise. There's the desire for fame, right? And it looks like we, and there's other desires as well, but it looks like human beings out of this, given the fact of competition and given this psychological egoism, right? What we're looking for is we try to know more, we want to live easier, we want praise, and we want fame, right? And guess what? That looks particularly accurate, right? It looks like, in fact, human beings do act like this, right? Okay, so Hobbes begins to then, in this chapter, offer a whole psychology of manners. What I want to do is sort of read through some of these quotes and sort of talk about them, right? Number one, he writes, to have received from one to whom we think ourselves equal greater benefits than there is hope to requite disposes to counterfeit love, but really to secret hatred, right? So he has this sense here that when we receive from another person other than ourselves greater benefits than there is hope to get, this ultimately means creates a sort of counterfeit love, but really a secret hatred. So Hobbes' view here is that we have a sort of negative view of each other here, ultimately. But he goes on to say that, so he thinks that we can treat each other as liking each other, but we don't really like each other. But then, by contrast, when we receive benefits from one whom we acknowledge as superior, this inclines us to love each other, right? So think about it, for instance, if there's another person in your class who's really on par with you, and you see yourself as being essentially the same as being like them, or you see yourself as equivalent to them or equal with them, and they give you a bunch of benefits that you can't stop. This means that you like them, but really you don't like them, because by their giving you these benefits, they're ultimately decreasing your power, right? But when someone who really is greater than us, who is beyond us and superior, and they give us benefits, then that means we love them naturally, he thinks, right? Because there's no hope for us to have that same sort of power. So it's not a decrease in our personal power, it's actually an increase, right? He goes on to say, to have done more hurt to a man than he can or is willing to expiate, inclines the doer to hate the sufferer. For we must expect revenge or forgiveness, both of which are hateful. So this is sort of very interesting, right? You can see, I think he has a very sort of negative view of human nature. This goes back to that quote, I was born, but so was fear, right? Twins were born, both myself and fear. And you can see here, I think Hobbes has a very, very negative view of human nature and very distrustful. But I have to be careful there. It's not just negative. I think it's secular, right? I think that Hobbes is giving us really an examination of humankind, human nature, that is very sort of kind of, well, this is just how people act. And it gives rise to all these things like forgiveness, but really these are just both forms of hatred, right? Now he says, men that distrust their own subtlety are in tumult and sedition better disposed for victory. Now it's an important point here. What does that mean? Well, people who distrust their own power per se, right? And in a situation where everything's going wrong, there's in tumult or there's sedition, there's revolution, right? They're better disposed to win because they have a degree of humility. And that's how I understand Hume there, or Hobbes there, right? He goes on to say, men that have a strong opinion of their own wisdom and matter of government are disposed towards ambition, right? So if you think you're really wise in terms of not necessarily political government, but think in terms of doing things. If you think you're wise in terms of doing something and you know how to get things done, you probably have ambition towards that thing, right? So again, it's sort of psychological type of manner. He also goes on to say that want of science, that is the ignorance of causes, disposes, or rather constrains a man to rely on advice and the authority of others. Now, I put this one in red because I think this is important. Remember, the manners are how we can come together and live in peace. And he's saying here that when we don't have scientific knowledge, when we don't know what causes other things, and we don't know the causes of things, this means that we're forced to really rely upon the advice and the authority of others. And that seems totally true, but you can see here is that when you rely upon the advice and authority of others, this does signal a diminishment of power. Okay, now Hobbes then jumps into the question of religion here. Now remember, for Hobbes, he's living in a highly, highly religious society. Hobbes himself is religious to a certain degree, right? He doesn't overtly challenge the notion that there is a God. He suggests that there is a God, but he also distinguishes here the notion of natural religion, I think, where he thinks that, of course, a lot of religions are false. Now, one thing to recognize is that for Hobbes, religion is peculiarly human, right? So first thing we should recognize is that animals don't seem to have religion, right? So that means that there must be something about our natural human condition that enables us to become religious, right? So there's sort of three points he starts out with. Number one, when we talk about religion, we can talk about it in terms of being related to an inquisitiveness of the causes of events and the search for good fortune. That is, human beings are naturally see things occur in the world, right? There's a huge blizzard, so you can ask yourself, why is there a blizzard? And we also naturally want to, and he's laid it out already by this point, we want good fortune, we don't want to die. So because of these things, right, he thinks that that's the first sort of point, is that we have a natural inquisitiveness related to the causes of things, and we naturally desire good fortune. Number two, religion also seems to arise from the idea that everything has a cause, right? And number three, humans recognize chains of causal events, but do not know the true causes of things, or do not know the first causes of things. So it has a lot to do with, again, our senses of the world, and we recognize that there's a sense, an order of fit in our sensations, and it must be related to these causal relations. So it's snowing right now. It's not really snowing here at this moment, but if it's snowing right now, I realize that something must cause the snow to fall, right? And so I realize that there's causes to all these things. I'm seeking good fortune, right? But ultimately, I don't know what the final first cause, what really causes things. Now, Hobbes' view here is that if you take these first two things together, this creates anxiety, right? I realize that everything has a cause, I'm curious about them, and I also am seeking good fortune. He thinks that this creates in us an anxiety, and ultimately a sort of perpetual fear. And so this is one of these two features put together indicate a particular origin for religion. Namely, we seek religion because religion will provide for us an alleviation of fear and anxiety, right? So I can ask myself, well, why did the blizzard come and kill, or let's change it, why did the earthquake hit and kill all of these people? Well, maybe because it comes God's will, right? Because God's will, and it would solve the reason for why the causes, and if I'm looking for good fortune, well, then I just need to become in favor with God. And so what do I do? Maybe, for instance, maybe we should, have some sacrifices to God. We should say some prayers, get in right favor with God, and we can alleviate that anxiety. So one of the causes for religion for Hobbes is fear, right? It's fear. But this third reason, the notion that we recognize a chain of events but don't know the true cause of things, this seems to account for our notion of a quote, it seems to account for, quote, the acknowledgement of one God that's eternal, infinite, and omnipotent, end quote. There should be an end quote there. So basically, the philosophical concept of an infinite monotheistic God for him is ultimately related to the notion that what we're looking for is the originating cause of all things, what in medieval scholastic is referred to as the final cause of things, God being the final cause of all things. So, and this is important, I think it is important here that because of the chain of causal events, whatever the first final cause is, it has to be the cause for all things, so there can only be one of them, hence one God, and it has to always be, it has to be infinite, omnipotent, and eternal, ultimately, because it's the only thing that could account for this. Now, Hobbes is well aware himself of the medieval and the scholastic view of God, arguments for God's existence. And ultimately here, I think what he's doing is he's saying, he's providing us a secular as well as, I think, a scholastic definition or an account of religion. The third sort of reason here, I think, in many ways, is not that original. But I think the first two, his analysis of the origin of religion is coming from fear, is very secular, very modern. And this is something original and new, I think, for Hobbes. Now, it is important to realize that some forms of religion are not natural, right? And he talks about, for instance, when we talk about immaterial spirits or the incorporeal, think about, for instance, when people talk about, or think about the way that the ancient Greeks probably imagined Zeus, right? Or think about the way in which people today imagine ghosts, or they talk about ghosts. These all seem to be not natural because they don't seem to originate from sensation. They seem to be the result of imagination, though, right? So some a lot of religious view a lot of religion is the result, especially natural religion, is the result of just imagination, motivated out of this perpetual fear, right? So ultimately, there seems to be two sources of religion for Hobbes. The first is that, well, it looks like one source for religion maybe that it's just the invention of culture, right? It's ultimately a form of politics, he says, right? It's a way of having consent and power, right? And I think many people today actually have this view. And it's interesting, in our series here, we're beginning with Descartes, we're ending with Nietzsche, and we'll see that Nietzsche really agrees with Hobbes right here, is that really he thinks religion is this invention of culture, and it has a sort of political dimension. It's about power over others, and it's about power over fear, I think. Now, the second possible source of religion is it's God's commandment and direction. And I think Hobbes here is being consistent with the political and the academic climate of his own world. Right. Hobbes cannot overtly be argue for atheism because of his concrete political and cultural situation, his historical context. So the other possible source of religion is, well, God's the source of religion. God gives a command and directs us. And there's problems with that, but Hobbes doesn't go into it. So there's the, so he gives an account, a modern account of religion, but he doesn't criticize or directly criticize or challenge the notion that there's a God. Okay, so now what we're going to see here in chapter 13 is Hobbes will move to the discussion of the natural condition of mankind and ultimately how this natural condition forms the basis of the political system, right? And it'll be interesting here because one of the reasons that Hobbes was quite controversial, especially for this book, The Leviathan, is that he gives a secularized, or that is, a natural account for politics and ultimately the source of power and authority for monarchy, right? One of the important sort of, you're probably familiar with it, the important theories in the medieval and in the, really, even after Hobbes, an important element for a political philosophy here was the idea that a king's power was absolute. It was called absolutism, and that absolute power was derived from God, that is, from God's commands and all that sort of thing. So there, on the one hand, this is the sort of kind of natural thing, because if you're a king, right, and think here, when a person is crowned, right, when they're coronated, who's the person who coronates them? It's usually a priest, right? Even if you go back and watch the Queen Elizabeth get her coronation, right, who coronates her? Well, I believe it's the head of the Anglican Church, right? So there's this notion that politics derives ultimately from God's authority and all this. Hobbes doesn't really think this, actually. He thinks that ultimately politics derives from our natural condition, right? And that we can give, if you will, a non-religious explanation for these things. We don't need to rely upon sort of absolutist theories about God. Now, it's to be clear here that Hobbes' view is that the monarch has absolute authority, or near absolute authority. He just doesn't think it derives from God. It derives from our natural condition. Now, human beings, when we want to talk about our natural conditions, the first thing we have to recognize is that human beings are naturally equal in terms of their mind and body. That is, human beings have a natural equality in terms of their natural power. Now, it's true that some people are stronger and some people are smarter. But he says, on the whole, it all washes out. I mean, you can tell this because even the strongest person there is can be killed by someone who's just cunning and smart, who's weak, right? So having bodily power is not enough, right, to overcome other people because it looks like we're generally equal, right? And science is another example. Because we all can think, or at least most of us can think, and we have this natural mental ability, science is something we can all have access to, and we can use science against each other. So there's a certain sort of equality of mind and body. Now, the second thing here is this equality, he says, we have an equality of ability, but this equality of ability gives rise to an equality of hope. Right, so this means that we're all in a natural state, and here imagine a pre-political state where there's no government, there's no politics, there's no culture, every person is on a desert island against everyone else. They're all naturally equal in mind and body, they all have this natural equality, but they all naturally hope that they can too be king, they can be in charge, and they can get it all. But there's a problem here, which is namely the fact of scarcity. There's not enough to go around for everyone. Well, because of this fact of scarcity, conflict emerges. Conflict emerges because everyone's trying to get the same thing, right? So this means that when we talk about the conflict of emergence, well, we can talk about conflict in three different ways, three sources, if you will, of conflict. The one is we can have conflict out of competition. We compete to gain something, right? So I want the island and you want the island, so we go to war for it. Right, or I want the coconut and you want the coconut, so we go to war for it. There's also diffidence. So diffidence here is this notion that I want power and I want safety, right? And I don't want to be hurt, right? And so what we do is we can also go into conflict in order for safety. So I see that suddenly that you're picking up a rock to throw at me so you can get the coconut. So what do? I pick up a rock and throw it at you first, right? So conflict emerges for safety. Also, conflict emerges out of glory or for reputation. So, I guess in this case, I want to be, the person who has the glory for getting the first coconut. So I go into we conflict with each other because I want to be the leader and have all the glory, right? So he thinks that conflict emerges naturally between competition, diffidence, and glory, right? Now, in the natural state, therefore, so if we ask ourselves, what would in a pre-political situation, what does this mean? Well, it means we're in a war of all against all. It means everyone is against each other, right? He says, quote, so the nature of war consists not in actual fighting, but in the known disposition thereto. During all time, there is no assurance to the contrary. All other time is peace. So what he's saying here is, in a natural state, everyone is against each other, so you have a war of all against all. So the natural state is a state of war. But a state of war doesn't necessarily mean that you're actually in fighting physically, but it means that there's never certainty that you won't have to fight, right? So that means that and you know that there's a disposition in which there is not necessarily any safety, right? So this is what war is. And this is sort of an important point, is a state of war is not necessarily a state of fighting. It could just be that there's no certainty that you won't fight. And here, think about the Cold War between the United States and the then Soviet Union. The Soviet Union and the United States were not physically at war, they weren't fighting per se, but it looked like they were at a state of war in terms of the disposition towards fighting. Right, there was never certainty whether or not fighting could erupt at any moment. Now, his view here is that the war is the natural condition, actually, and then when you don't have war, that's when you have peace. So it's interesting here that he defines peace by war, right? So in a war of all against all, you can't have flourishing, you can't have industry, you can't have transportation, you can't have art, you can't have letters, you can't have sight, you can't have anything, in fact. It's a state of continual fear. In fact, at one point in this chapter, Hobbes describes it. He says that life in a state of nature or in a war of all against all is one in which life is short, miserable, and brutish, right? So life is short, we act like animals, and it's just a miserable sort of thing, right? In next thing he mentioned here is that in a state of war, or at least in a state of war of all against all, nothing is unjust in a state of nature. So there's no concept of justice. So this is an important difference here. This means that for Hobbes, justice is not an internal state. It's not a virtue like it is in Aristotle. For him, justice is a common power, and it's the power that enables peace. But in a war, in a state of nature, there is no peace and there is no common power. And so not only is there no justice, strictly speaking, there's no injustice either, right? So this means that everyone is justified to do whatever they do, right? So in a state of nature, if I see you and I want your canoe and I hit you over the head to take it and I kill you, strictly speaking for Hobbes, that's not unjust, right? Because there's an equality of power and everyone can lay claim to everything equally, right? And that only gets worked out through violence. So no actions are unjust in a state of nature because justice is this common power, which is what we call law. Now, justice as a common power can be understood as a process procedure. It's a way of proceeding and way of adjudicating things, but it's not a faculty of mind, and it's certainly but it is a quality of social existence. So this is very important. Justice is not some universal form that we contemplate and apply to the world. Justice, by contract, is a certain quality of social existence. So the passions that incline, I should say incline, that incline men to peace are derived, though, from laws of nature. So the question, though, is where do we get peace from? Why aren't we in a state of nature? Because clearly we're not going around killing each other. He thinks that this comes to his natural law theory or his theory regarding the laws of nature. He thinks that given our psychological situation, right, we ultimately can articulate certain things that we naturally are after, certain sort of precepts that guide human conduct, which will explain how social justice can arise. Now, he'll start off here by articulating a couple key terms, and I threw up a couple of them, not all of them here. The first is jus naturel, and this is the notion, he says, it refers to the liberty that each has to use their own power as they will themselves for self-preservation, right? So you might call this natural justice or something like this. Natural justice is you naturally use your own power for your own self-preservation. That makes sense, and it conforms with his egoism here and his analysis of the manners and the power. Now, what is liberty? Well, liberty is the absence of external impediments. And what is an impediment? An impediment is something that removes power. So liberty is guided by judgment and reason to so think about it this way. If I want to go down the street and buy something at the store, right? Imagine if there's a wall of policemen there with shields stopping me. Well, now I no longer have the liberty to buy something, right? So that's what liberty is. Liberty is the absence of external impediments. And what does an impediment do? It removes my natural power or it removes another form of my power. Now, and when I do have liberty, I use my mind and I use my speech and I use my thoughts and I use reason and my judgment in order to figure out how to act, in order to gain more power, right? Now, what are laws of nature? A law of nature, he says, is the precept or general rule that's found out by reason, by which one is forbidden to do that which is destructive to their own life. So a law of nature always has something to do with self-preservation, as it were. Now, he ultimately articulates two precepts, two laws of nature that are really at the basis here. The first is that in a state of nature, due to the law of nature, one seeks peace, right? Because the state of nature is such a disaster, right? You get the war of all against all, and there's no justice, and at any moment I'm terrified that I'm going to get killed for my canoe, etc., right? Because of this, one naturally wants peace, right? One wants to get out of that state of nature. So he thinks it's natural, there's a sort of natural law here. And again, here, this means that reason will naturally guide us towards peace. Second precept, that in order to get that peace, one must lay down their own right to all things. So, and this means that there's a voluntary divestment of liberty, right? So his view here is that the second natural law is that if I'm living in a state of nature, I naturally want peace. But secondly, I have to be willing to give up my rights to all things, right? My right to your canoe, right? My right to your coconut, and so forth. That means I give up my rights. So it's interesting here is that law, right? And morality ultimately require us to give up part of our natural freedom. And that means that's what it means to get out of a state of nature. Now, Hobbes does distinguish between rights and laws, which I think is important, right? For him, a right refers to my liberty to do something, whereas a law is that which determines and binds my liberty, right? So there's a difference here between a right and a law. Sometimes people get these confused, and certainly they did in Hobbes' day, so he makes a point to discuss it. Now, Hobbes then will begin to talk about contracts, and this is very important because what his argument is going to be is that in order to escape the state of nature, I give up my natural freedom and my natural right to do whatever I want. And that means I then agree to some sort of contract, right? I contract myself into a certain cultural condition. So what is a contract? Well, a contract is the mutual transferring of a right, right? So if you and I make a business deal, we make a contract. I say that I'm going to give you potatoes and you're going to give me, let's say, wheat, right? So what we've done is that when we do that contract, we say that I'm giving up my right to wheat, some of my wheat, so long as you give up some of your right or I'm sorry, I'm giving up my right to potatoes and you're going to give up some of your right to wheat. And there's a mutual transference. So that's what a contract is. Now, a contract requires fidelity, right? In order for, in a state of nature at least, if you make a contract with another person, it requires that you keep that contract, which means that ultimately you have to not only be faithful, but you have to sort of hope that the other person is going to be faithful. So in a state of nature, a contract really just depends only on trust, right? But you can see here that's not really good enough. Because what happens if you break your trust, right? What happens if when I show up to give you my potatoes and to take your wheat, you just hit me over the side of my head and take all the potatoes and the wheat for yourself, right? So I need something more than just making a contract with another person. What I need is I need some sort of civil state or some sort of condition that constrains those people who would attempt to violate trust, right? How do you constrain people who violate trust? Well, you constrain them through fear, right? See, he this continual discussion of fear comes over and over again for Hobbes. And how do you do that? Well, it's quite simple. You say if you violate your contract, you will lose your liberty in some way, in some degree. And losing your liberty may mean that you're no longer allowed to make contracts, or it could be we imprison you, we take away your liberty of movement. Right? Think about people who commit murder. They violate a general contract not to kill people. And how do we, and what the state does is it enforces that contract through punishment, right? So any covenant that denies one's own defense, therefore, would have to be void. And let me take a look here. I want to show you one other thing. He then begins to talk about these invalid covenants. So when we talk about covenant, not every contract or covenant is the same or is equal, right? A former covenant makes void a later. So if you make a covenant with me, and then 2 weeks you make another covenant that breaks my covenant, well, guess what? My covenant supersedes the later covenant. So earlier covenants have priority over later covenants, right? A covenant that not to defend oneself from force is always invalid, right? So for instance, I can never make a covenant in which, say for instance, I make an agreement that you have the right to injure me and hurt me. Well, what? He says that's never valid because it violates the law of nature of self-preservation and this egoism, right? So certain covenants you can't do. Now, a covenant to accuse oneself without assurance of a pardon is also an invalid covenant, right? So for instance, if I make an agreement that would actually injure me in some way, right? Well, unless you give me some sort of a pardon, then it's not a valid covenant, right? And this is actually the philosophical basis for things like pleading the Fifth Amendment in the United States. Now, there's a question here, well, why keep a covenant? The answer is clear. Either one, fear of consequences, or two, there's pride in appearance of keeping your own words, of keeping your covenant. This goes back to the notion of glory and all of these other things, right? But fear is the key one here, right? So Hobbes ultimately has a view here that justice is based ultimately upon fear. Right. And he also says here, interestingly, says this means that oaths don't really add anything to an obligation. And this is, you start to see Hobbes' secularism. Most of the time when people take an oath, they take an oath before God or before a religious entity or something like this. He says this doesn't really matter because covenants, you're bound by your covenant, any covenant regardless. So an oath doesn't really add anything to an obligation. It doesn't add anything to a covenant. So oaths aren't really required or necessary. The covenant itself should be sufficient. So this is sort of interesting. You can see here that Hobbes is sort of disentangling some of the religious prescriptions regarding justice from out of his philosophy. Now, he goes on in chapter 15 to talk about some of the other laws of nature, and I'm going to go through this quickly. I don't really want to get ground down into all the details of this chapter, but he does talk about a couple important things, right? So what is injustice? Well, injustice then is a breach of covenant. So you can see here, out of a state of nature arises a covenant, which a covenant is to do X, and it is also to give up my rights to do other things. And this is a mutual transference. And that from this covenant, we have to have some sort of civil punishment, right, in order to enforce it. And so that means that injustice is a breach of covenant, right? And that means that the negation of injustice is justice. So what is justice? Justice means following through with your covenants and with your agreements. Now, when we talk about justice, we can talk about justice as being a state of justice. So if you're in a covenant and you haven't broken that covenant, you're in a state of justice, I suppose. But we can also talk about justice in terms of how we act with one another. He calls this justice of action. And justice of action is either commutative or it's distributive for Hobbes, right? Commutative justice refers to the equality of value between things, right? And distributive justice refers to the equality of benefit of things, right? And later on, we'll see that this is going to filter through into a very important distinction regarding justice. So we have a distinction, two types of justice of action, commutative justice, where you have an equality of value, right? So say, for instance, you give two children, you give them each one cookie, right? So you give them each one cookie, and in this case, well, I guess that's distributive, right? And it's also commutative, right? It's both, right? But not every commutative form of justice or distributive form of justice is the same. Now, he will then goes on to really lay out some of the basic moral concepts as being bound to these different laws of nature. He, for instance, talks about gratitude. And this is the notion that if someone repents, you should forgive them, essentially, right? That is, they realize they've broken the covenant. Now they want to return to a state of peace, which means you should be grateful to them. Or if someone helps you, you should be grateful to them. And that means that grace is required here, right? And one of the things I think Hobbes is doing is he's trying to realign all of the basic moral categories that people have and move them out of a religious framework and into this sort of secular, naturalistic framework, right? Now, he doesn't call it secular because, remember, in his view, God created nature, so ultimately God is still the source of everything, but we can understand it surely through reason and through the investigation of our natural condition. We don't have to open up the Bible to do it. It has the consequence of secularizing a lot of moral categories, right? He also has this notion that another natural law is what we call complaisance. And this is the idea that everyone strives to accommodate themselves to everyone else, right? So once we begin to make covenants, that means that we should naturally try to accommodate ourselves to everyone else insofar as we're able to. And this is a consequence of that earlier law of nature, which was self-preservation, which aims towards peace, right? This means we should pardon those who repent. Oh, I think I accidentally got gratitude and the pardoning confused, or I conflated them. Right? But this means another natural law is that you should pardon those who repent because it reinstates a state of peace. And then ultimately, another law of nature is that there should be retribution for violation. So if someone commits a crime, right, they should be punished. This is a natural law. So you can see here how he's building this really quite brilliant framework. Now, he talks about the golden rule ultimately, and he actually talks about a whole bunch of other laws of nature and different things that would relate. But ultimately, he thinks the golden rule really captures it, right? The golden rule is that you should do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And really, he thinks this is a natural law at the end of the day. Is that you should do, and because it makes sense in terms of making agreements that would be fair and equal to each other, right? Here's a quote. The laws of nature are immutable and eternal, for injustice, ingratitude, arrogance, pride, iniquity, acception of persons, and the rest can never be made lawful. For it can never be that war shall preserve life, and peace will destroy it, right? So ultimately, his moral theory is a sort of naturalistic moral theory. But it's naturalistic insofar as it's based upon our sort of, he doesn't use the term, but what I would call our psychology. Okay, now, this is sort of the end here. We're almost done with our discussion of Hume, of Hobbes. And he begins now to talk directly of the Commonwealth. And I'm sort of jumping here to chapter 17 on the causes, generation, and the definition of a Commonwealth, right? You can see here that personal preservation is the final cause for everyone. Everyone wants to survive. So that means that the goal is to escape a state of nature. Now, clearly, the laws of nature are there. We can use reason to figure this stuff out. But the laws of nature are not enough, right? Because without force, each person would have to rely upon their own strength, right? And that's just not going to be sufficient, right, in order to overcome this nightmarish state of nature. And he says, for instance, a small number of men combined does not afford enough security. So even if I make a covenant with a group of people, a pack of people, in a state of nature, just having that group of people is not going to be enough. And I have here sort of an example. I don't know how many of you watch The Walking Dead. I love The Walking Dead. Here's a scene from a picture from the most recent season. And you can see the heroes of The Walking Dead. The Walking Dead really is emblematic of what Hobbes is talking about here. Because in The Walking Dead, because of this zombie apocalypse, right? No one can trust anyone else. There's no laws. There's no justice. There's no injustice, as it were. Our heroes in the story or in the show or in the comic book, they bound together and they're a small band of people. But as you can see, even a small band of people who have an agreement with each other is not going to be enough if you're overwhelmed by force. Right, and sometimes this could happen. So if you watch The Walking Dead, this person here with the baseball bat, his name is Negan, and he overcomes our heroes, and he kills a couple of the main characters, and it's really a disaster, right? But it really sort of captures this Hobbesian world, I think. The laws of nature are not enough, right? Simply the main characters of The Walking Dead talking about the idea that why everyone should know that we should try to seek peace and work together. Well, guess what? That's not enough. What you need is you need a civil society. Now, Hobbes does take a moment to argue against Aristotle's politics. Now, if you've been watching any of my other video series, or you've taken previous courses in classical or political philosophy, you'll be familiar that Aristotle's politics signifies the notion that he thinks human beings are naturally social creatures. And he thinks that human beings are not naturally in competition, but rather would naturally work together. And Aristotle gives this example of bees. He says human beings are kind of like bees. They naturally work together in groups. Now, Hobbes totally disagrees with this. And ultimately, his view about the state of nature is in complete contradistinction to Aristotle's. And so, because Aristotle is the big philosopher, he's the big schoolman of the day, Hobbes takes a moment to attack Aristotle's view, right? And he doesn't think humans are like bees at all, right? He thinks that, yeah, sure, maybe you can say that humans are naturally social given the laws of nature, but you have to, number one, recognize that humans are in continual competition, right? Whereas bees are not, right? For bees, the common good is identical to the private good. right? So what's good for all bees is good for the individual bee. That's not the case with human beings, right? The other difference here is that animals don't have a personal use of reason. I do, you do, human beings do. So humans think for themselves, and what's good for the individual human is not necessarily good for the whole group, right? The other thing is animals don't have no words or speech, right? It's true, he says, that animals do seem to make little sounds, and they do have some sort of thing. We know today that bees, in fact, do communicate with each other, but they, for Hobbes, and I think the point is probably the same today for bees as well, is that the signals that bees give are not representative signs, right? They may seem to have a sort of dyadic relationship, a sort of kind of sense of exchange, where speech seems to be doing something else. It signals for us the faculty of imagination, and we can understand it, and so on and so forth. Animals don't seem to have this. Humans do. Irrational creatures cannot distinguish between injury and damage and cannot be offended by their fellows, right? So he gives this sort of example is that bees, for instance, don't get offended by each other, whereas human beings do because we have rationality, because we're rational creatures. So this means that animals, sure, they may have some sort of natural agreement, but they don't have covenants, right? They don't have a covenant in which they give up part of their rights in order to gain peace. Now, given these conditions, you can see that if you've agreed with Hobbes up to this point, you have to disagree with Aristotle. And really, from this point forward, I think that Hobbes really this discussion really creates a paradigm shift away from a classic Aristotelian view of politics and much more towards a modern conception. So you see, I wanted to include this discussion that he has about Aristotle, because you see a solid break here between the classic and the modern. And really throughout all of the Leviathan, Hobbes is attacking the classic model here. Now, this means that what do we do? Well, the only way to erect a common power, remember that's what he calls law, is to confer all their power, all of the power of the community, right? And to confer all that power and strength upon one person or upon an assembly of people that reduces all of their wills by a plurality of voices into one will. He calls this will the Leviathan. And here's the sort of picture of it that was actually published with his original, with the original printing of the Leviathan. Or this is a wood graving, I believe. And you can see the Leviathan actually refers to sort of a monster in the Bible. But you can see here is that we all give up our natural freedom and we let one person or one institution ultimately call the shots. And we give up our freedom. So this means that, and this is how ultimately society politics is created, right? We can't just have a sort of a small group, a band of people. We have to create a large community that institutionally gives up its power to a one unified entity, right? And of course, Hobbes is thinking clearly of monarchy here in the king, right? So the multitude in one is a commonwealth, and the multitude in one is what we call the sovereign. All become subjects to the sovereign. So everyone becomes subjugated to the sovereign. Now, what are the rights of the sovereign by institution? Now, I think it's important to recognize here that all of the rights are derived from the institution of the commonwealth, right? So this is really important because we have to recognize that the commonwealth is an institution. It is a process whereby we work together, but we've given up our rights, and that we're organized under the heading of this sovereign Leviathan, whether that be a monarch or whether or not it be an assembly or a republic. So for him, the Roman Republic or Greek democracy or of course, British monarchy, all of these things are institutions of commonwealth. So these are all commonwealths and they're all institutions. Now, what is the sovereign allowed to do? You'll see that Hobbes essentially thinks the sovereign's allowed to do anything. Almost anything, pretty much anything, right? And let me run through these, right? The covenant that's made between all of the people in the commonwealth supersedes all of the former covenants that are repugnant to the commonwealth, right? So even if I have so imagine we're living in a state of nature, and it's like, or imagine it's the Walking Dead, and we've made agreements with each other, but as soon as we create a commonwealth, a government, a country, all of those sort of small agreements go out the window if those small agreements are in some way repugnant or contrary to the commonwealth and to the Leviathan, right? And this means that all of the covenants are subject to the monarch, and all the people are subjects of the monarch, and they can't take leave without consent, right? So that means that you can't end the commonwealth unless the Leviathan says you can. So the sovereign is truly sovereign. Once you enter into this commonwealth, you can't get out of it, essentially. He says, too, there can happen no breach of covenant on the part of the sovereign, right? So the sovereign can in no way break the covenant. Right. We'll see. There is one minor way in which maybe that's going to happen. And we'll see. He says it's when the sovereign can no longer protect you, because the whole basis of the social covenant is for protection. So that's one important caveat. But the sovereign can't breach the covenant, even if, for instance, you don't like what the sovereign's doing. Right. I'll give you an example. You know, recently, Donald Trump became president of the United States. He's not the sovereign, strictly speaking, but he has all this power, right? And if Hobbes was here, Hobbes would say, listen, you may not like what Donald Trump's going to do, but he is the sovereign. And he can't breach the covenant simply by what he does. Now, to be clear, that's not really the case with Donald Trump in the United States system, but that's how Thomas Hobbes would see it. There can be no breach of covenant on the part of the sovereign. Number three. A covenant made by the majority of persons binds the minority that dissents. So you can see here, you first get this sense in Hobbes that the covenant has to initially begin by a majority of the people. The majority has to agree to it. But once the majority agrees to it, the people who disagree are forced to follow along, right? So even though there's a minority that dissents, they are also bound by the covenant. So when the sovereign creates a law that you don't like, you still have to follow it. Now, number four, it's impossible for the sovereign to injure his subjects, for the authority is based on and from the subjects. So Hobbes really gives carte blanche power to the sovereign. And his view here is that no matter what the sovereign does, right, the sovereign is basically in the right, and the sovereign can't injure the subjects because the subjects have given him or her or them all of the power. So this means that even if the sovereign does something, and really think about the king, if the king doesn't like me and then decides to have me executed, well, guess what? Strictly speaking, because I've given up my freedom to that sovereign, that the sovereign's commands are not unjust. Right, which means they're not injuring me. Now, obviously, personally, being executed would be a bad thing for me, right? But strictly speaking, the sovereign can't hurt the subjects because the authority is based on the subjects. The sovereign cannot justly be put to death, so you can't execute the sovereign. Now, here, of course, remember, Hobbes is living in England under a really powerful monarchy, right? So that means he's really protecting the notion of the king here, right? You can't put the monarch to death. And again, he always talks about the monarch as being male, right? He always refers to the sovereign as he. So I'll use he interchangeably here. Six, he says, the sovereign is the judge of the opinions and the doctrines and what's conducive to peace. So the sovereign is the one who decides, right? The sovereign, seven, has the power of making all of the rules and civil laws. And here you can see that this is the big difference between a republican system and a monarchy, right? Or a democracy or a republic are both different from a monarchy. But a strict monarchy, right? Hobbes' view is that the king can do whatever he wants. He can make all the laws, right? Number eight, the sovereign has the right to adjudicate. So he thinks that the sovereign also has the right to adjudicate whether or not someone's just or unjust, whether or not they follow the law or not. The sovereign decides. The sovereign has the right of making war and peace with other nations. Nine, ten, the sovereign has the right to choose all the counselors, ministrates, magistrates, and officers in both peace and war. So the sovereign gets to decide who's in the court. 11, the sovereign has the power to reward with riches and punish with corporal or pecuniary punishment. So the sovereign can both reward, but the sovereign can also punish. And number 12, the sovereign has the power to give titles of honor. So the sovereign has all the power in Hobbes' system. We're going to see later on when we talk about Hobbes and his political philosophy that for him, the government is sovereign, not the king. And this is different because you have a differentiation of branches of government and things like that. And so in the American system, you would say is that strictly speaking, the sovereign really, the sovereign power really resides with all three branches of government and primarily in the legislative branch. But for Hobbes, he's not defending democracy here. He's not defending republicanism. What he's defending here ultimately is the right, is the abstract right of a sovereign to decide. And of course, a monarch is most directly a type of sovereign. Now, I'm really sort of done here, and I really want to sort of end the video because I've gone on a long time here, and I appreciate your watching this. And here we conclude with chapter 21, where Hobbes begins to talk about the liberty of subjects and of freedom. And what I really want to talk about in this is I want to pull out the limits of what the sovereign are. Now, he does talk quite a bit about liberty and what liberty means here. He does say that a freeman is he that in those things which by his strength and wit he's able to do is not hindered to do what he has a will to do. So he thinks that in a commonwealth, citizens should be freemen, right? A citizen should be free to do what they do, of course, within the bounds and under the covenant set by, or the covenant of the sovereign, the covenant with the sovereign that created and legitimizes the sovereign. But this does mean that the sovereign's power does not reside in God. It does not reside in religion. It resides rather in our natural condition. And in our escape from the natural condition. This means that there are mortal limits to the sovereign. This means that the sovereign is not necessarily in practice all-powerful, or this doesn't mean that a sovereign can necessarily in practice remain sovereign indefinitely, right? So for instance, a sovereign, well, let me read you the quote here. He says, "The obligations of subjects to the sovereign is understood to last as long and no longer than the power last, by which he's able to protect them," right? So you can see here that if the sovereign loses power, right, and there's really a return to potential, to a state where there's potential violence, then at that point, the sovereign is become, is died, right? The sovereign no longer exists. And here you can think about, for instance, think about the civil war, the recent civil war in Syria. Right, you have a whole bunch of people killing each other. At that point, if you're living in Aleppo or in another city in Syria, and you live day to day worried if you're going to get killed, right? It's clear that there's no longer a sovereign power, right? Even though there may be a person called the president, it doesn't, right? President Bashar al-Assad, right? It doesn't matter because even though he has the title of being a sovereign, right, the power of the sovereignty no longer exists because there is no longer any protection. Well, so what this means is that the sovereignty of the sovereign and the social covenant that the people have with the sovereign can be destroyed through foreign wars, importantly through ignorance, right? He thinks that if you have a fool who's the king, then yeah, that he can destroy things because he may, you know, through ignorantly destroy the ability to protect people and to protect his people and also the passions of men. So you can have someone like Nero, for instance, who no longer is protecting the people of Rome when he sets Rome on fire. Strictly speaking, that no longer, you've ended the sovereign, you've reached the limits of the sovereignty. So that means that the end of the sovereign, oops, there's a little misspelling there, sorry. I hate it. When I make these videos, I always go through and see if I can find spelling errors, but I always find them when I'm recording them, so I appreciate your patience with me. But at the end here, what we see is that the end of the sovereign results in is either a return to a state of nature and a war of all against all, right? Or it immediately is followed by the emergence of a new sovereign, right? So the end of the sovereign is a return to the state of nature, right? And this gives us Hobbes' sense. So you can see that unlike the philosophy we looked at last week with Descartes, and by the way, there's more to talk about with Hobbes, but we just don't have time to go through it all. You can see is that Hobbes' discussion in his analysis of where knowledge comes from, it comes from our experience and from our sensations. He builds up this model that ultimately works its way from how we know things and what it means to know things all the way into an analysis of where our moral concepts come from and where the political authority and where the natural authority of justice resides. And so we get a sort of social political philosophy out of Hobbes. What you're going to see within a future video is when we take a look at John Locke. John Locke is also brilliant and he does both things, but he does them, I think, more masterfully and more with more precision than ultimately Thomas Hobbes does. But it's quite remarkable philosophy. So this concludes our video for modern philosophy. So I want to thank you guys for watching the history of modern philosophy. And in our next video here, I believe we're going to be taking a look at John Locke. So thank you very much for watching. I look forward to seeing you guys online.